We're going to learn Eruvin Daf Tzadik Ches. We're going to start from the Mishnah, seven lines from the bottom of Daf Tzadik Zayin Omid Beis. Says the Mishnah, Hoyo Kore Basefer. If somebody was reading from a Sefer, it would typically be one of the sacred scrolls, as we call it, one of the Chov Dalet Sforim, the 24 Sforim of the Tanakh. And the way that they used to be written back in the days, they were all written on scrolls. And somebody was standing alo askupa on a threshold, which was usually between, we'll see in the Gemara, but usually at the entranceway of a home between the Rishus HaYochid, which is the home, and the Rishus HaRabim outside, there was a threshold. And we have to discuss in the Gemara the status of this threshold. But he was standing on this threshold, v'nizgalgil ha-sefer miyodoi. And one end of the scroll was still in his hand, but the other side of the scroll rolled away from him. And it rolled onto the floor of the Rishus HaRabim. He's allowed to pull the scroll back to him. Since he's holding the scroll in one hand, it's as if it hasn't left the entity where he is, and therefore pulling it back, it does not include, does not become a one of the melochis of carrying on Shabbos. Continues the Mishnah, stage two, a different case. Not that he's standing on the askupa and it rolled down into the Rishus HaRabim, rather, Hoyo Koire Beroish HaGag, he was reading from this scroll on a rooftop, v'nizgalgal ha-sefer miyodoi, and the one side of this scroll rolled down away from him, ad sheloi higia la'asara tvachim, provided that the lower end of the scroll has not reached within 10 tfachim from the Rishus HaRabim, he can draw the sefer, the scroll, back to him. The 10 tfachim is the amount of airspace that is associated to Rishus HaRabim. So if the other side of the scroll didn't reach the area, the airspace of the Rishus HaRabim, then he can pull the scroll back. Misha yigia la'asara tfachim, the Tanakhama hold that if the scroll reached within 10 tvachim from the Rishus HaRabim, then you're not allowed to draw it back, even though min ha-Torah there's no issue here, because he's still holding one side of the scroll in his hand on the rooftop. It's not considered as if the scroll is in the Rishus HaRabim. However, since in the event that the whole scroll would fall down to where the lower end of the scroll is, then it would be in the Rishus HaRabim, and you would not be allowed to draw it back into, take it into Rishus HaRabim, so the Tanakhama say it's also to pull it back into Rishus HaRabim. So what should he do to protect the scroll, or at least to minimize the level of degradation to the scroll? He should turn it over, he should flip it over, that the words, the text, should be facing down and not so exposed. Rabbi Yehuda argues with the Tanakhama, afilu ein masuluk min haoretz elo kamaloi machat, providing that it has not yet arrived and reached the ground, it's just the distance of a machat, of a needle's distance away from the ground, but it's not yet on the ground, it's still hanging, it's still suspended, then goylo le'etzlo, he can roll the scroll back to him. Reb Shimon says, "Afilu ba'aretz atzmoi." Even if it's actually reached the ground, since it's only one side of the scroll has reached the ground, and the other side of the scroll is still in his hands, goylo le'etzlo, he can draw the whole scroll back to him. She'ein lecha dovar mishum shvus. There is no issa derabbanon, which was oimed b'fnei kisvei kodesh, that will prevent us from upholding the honor and respect to the kisvei kodesh. Says the Gemara, Hai iskupa heichedomi. This threshold, what is its status? What type of threshold are we talking about? Ileim iskupa rishus hayochid. Are we talking about an iskupa threshold, which is 10 tvachim high and 4 tvachim wide, and it has the status of a rishus hayochid? Vekomo rishus harabim, and the area in front of the threshold is a rishus harabim. Veloigaz rinon dilma nofil v'osi la'asuye. And then the ratio that says that one is allowed to draw back the scroll into the askupa, it must be that we're not worried, we don't make a gezeira decree that you may come to bring the scroll back to you, even if the whole scroll fell to where just part of the scroll fell. Because if the askupa is Rishus HaYochid, and it fell to the Rishus HaRabim, and if the whole scroll fell to the Rishus HaRabim, and you bring it back to the askupa, to the Rishus HaYochid, you're going to be transgressing carrying Rishus to Rishus. And here, that since You're holding one side of the scroll. You're not worried. Such a gzeira, then who must that be following? Mani Reb Shimon he. It must be Reb Shimon in the second half of the Mishnah, when the Mishnah is talking about a scroll that fell from the rooftop, which is Rishus HaYochid, towards the Rishus HaRabim. And Reb Shimon said, even if it lands in the Rishus HaRabim, the Reb Shimon says, Ein lecha dova mishom shvus oimud b'fnei kisvei kodesh. So the very first case in the Mishnah would seem to be following Reb Shimon. The Omar kol dova shum mishom shvus ein oimud b'fnei kisvei kodesh. If so, the reading of the Mishnah will be a little bit challenging. Eimah Sefer. Let's go to the second part of the Mishnah. The second part of the Mishnah says, Rabbi Yehuda Eimer afilu ein masuluk min ha'oretz elo melo yachut, goyle lo yetzlei. That Rabbi Yehuda says that if the scroll fell from the roof down towards the Rishus HaRabim, but it has not yet landed on the Rishus HaRabim, it's just a tiny bit away from the Rishus HaRabim, you can still draw it back to him because it hasn't yet landed. Rabbi Shimon Oimir, and over there in the second case of the Mishnah, Rabbi Shimon argues and says, Afilu ba'oretz atzmo, even if it landed on the ground, goyle lo yetzlei. He can bring it back to him. In which case, Reisha, the very first case of the Mishnah, assuming that the Askupa is Rishus HaYochid, is Reb Shimon. Reisha v'Seifa, and the end of the second case, which is explicit in the Mishnah, Reb Shimon, it's Reb Shimon. Mitzi also. But the first opinion with the second case, when it fell from the roof towards the Rishus HaRabim, is Reb Yehuda. And does that make sense that the first case should be the same opinion as the last statement in the Mishnah, and in between the two, there's a different opinion? Answers the Gemara, Omar Rav Yehuda. There's going to be three answers here. Rav Yehuda explains as follows. In, yes, Reisha v'Seifa, Reb Shimon, Metziosa, Rav Yehuda. The very first case of the Mishnah is Reb Shimon, and then the Mishnah then brings a different case, which is a Machlekas, where it first brings Rav Yehuda, and then again Reb Shimon. A second explanation, Rabba Omar, that hocha beiskupo hanidreses oskinon. There's a fundamental difference between the first case and the second case. And the first case is actually not only Reb Shimon, even Reb Yehuda would agree. Why? Because the case that Reb Yehuda argued with Reb Shimon is when the scroll fell down from the rooftop towards the Rishus HaRabim. But no one's actually going to trample on this scroll, it's just dangling down. So in that case, Reb Yehuda says that if it hasn't yet landed, then you can draw it back. But if it's already resting on the ground, you should not draw it back because of this gezeira. Had the whole scroll landed in the Rishus HaRabim and you bring it back to Rishus HaYochid, it will be severely osa. But that's only in that case. In the case of the Askupa, we're talking about an Askupa, which is a Rishus HaYochid, but it's nidreses. It's a place, in a public place, where many people are going to trample on this. And if you leave the scroll there, it's not just that the scroll is dangling and it's not such a dignified way to keep a scroll. It's actually a very degrading because people are going to trample on this kisvei kodesh. It's a skupa hanidreses askinon umbishum bizoyin kisvei kodesh, and it's a severe degradation to the kisvei kodesh. Shor rabbonon. In that case, even Rabbi Yehuda agrees to Rabbi Shimon that one is allowed to draw back the scroll. Eisvei Abaye. Abaye is now asking a question on the way that Rabbi explained the Mishnah. We learnt in a brisa. Abaye had such a brisa. Rashi says he doesn't know where this brisa is, but Abaye had such a brisa that regarding this askupa, the first case in the Mishnah, where the scroll was being held by somebody standing on this threshold, and we now assume that this askupa is Rishus HaYochid. It fell into the Rishus HaRabim. So in the brisa says, Toich Dalet Amos. If it's within 4 amos of the threshold, it didn't fall further away. The other end of the scroll did not fall further, or did not fall 4 amis away. Goylele etzle, that's when the halacha is, like it says in the Mishnah, you can draw the scroll back. Chutzle dalet, however, if the scroll fell away from dalet amis, hoifchoy al haksav, in that case, you're not allowed to draw the scroll back, and the most you can do is turn the scroll on its face, that the letters should be less exposed. So Abai is now asking that we have to remember, the fact that the other half of the scroll is still being held in the area of the askupa in the Rishus HaYochid, so however far it falls, it's not going to be a min ha-Torah. Drawing it back, even if it lands in Rishus HaRabim, it doesn't matter if it's close to the, within 4 amos or outside 4 amos, it's definitely not going to be an issa min ha-Torah. In the event that the whole scroll were to fall out, it doesn't really make a difference. If it fell less than 4 amos, and bringing it back from the Rishus HaRabim into Rishus HaYochid is severely osur. Or if it fell more than 4 amos, and then besides for bringing it back into the Rishus HaYochid, we have an issue of taking something 4 amos in the Rishus HaRabim. So Abai is asking, if we're talking about that this is a type of askupa where people are going to trample it, and therefore everybody agrees that as long as it's not osur min hatayra in the present state, because part of the scroll is still by the askupa, then it's mutter to bring it back. Mali toich dalad amis, mali chutz ledalad amis. What's the difference if it's within 4 amis or less than 4 amis? What's the difference? Elo Omar Abaye, we have now a third explanation of the Mishnah. Hocha be'iskupas karmelis askinon. Not like the first two explanations that the askupa was a Rishus HaYochid. We're talking about that this askupa was 4x4 tvachim wide, but it was not 10 tvachim high. So it's got the status of a karmelis. Rishus HaRabim oiveres lefonel. And in front of it, you've got a Rishus HaRabim. And obviously the other side of the askupa, you've got a home which is a Rishus HaYochid. But this person is standing on the askupa, which is a karmelis, and the scroll fell down into the Rishus HaRabim. So toich dalad amos, in the event that it didn't fall 4 amos, then de'inofil, in the event, and that's what the Gemara says right at the bottom of Tadig Zayin Amud Beis, that the gzeiros we're talking about is what would be the case if the whole scroll fell to the place where now just part of the scroll fell. So if it's within dalad amos, de'inofil umaisilo, even if the whole scroll would have fallen to that place, umaisilo, and he brings it back to the askupa, lo yosi lidei chiyuv chatos, he will not have transgressed a biblical issa of carrying, because to carry from Rishus HaRabim into a Karmelis is not a Deraisa. And therefore, Shori Le Rabbonon, and therefore in this case, they were allowed to bring the scroll back because not the whole scroll had fallen out. Chutz Led Arba Amis, however, if the part of the scroll fell outside the 4 Amis, De'imaiselei, then in the event that if the whole scroll had fallen outside the 4 Amis, and he would bring it back, Osi Lidei Chiyuv Chatos, because there it would involve carrying 4 Amis in Rishus HaRabim, with in and of its own is an Issa Deraisa, and therefore Lo Shori Le Rabbonon, we can understand that the Chachomim said that you're not, the Rabbonon, referring to Rabbi Yehuda, said that you're not allowed to. But the Reisha is according to everybody, and that's how Abai explains the Mishnah. Asks the Gemara, in the same way as you understand that if it's outside 4 amos and carrying 4 amos in Rishus HaRabim, if in the event that the whole scroll was outside in Rishus HaRabim 4 amos away, would be a chiyuv deraisa. And we said that if it's less than 4 amos, it would never be an issa deraisa because the askupa is a karmelis. But what's on the other side of the askupa? The home is Rishus HaYochid. Why don't we say Dilma Ma'il Rishus HaRabim Rishus HaYochid? Why are we not concerned? He's going to take this, that if in the event that the scroll fell, the whole scroll fell into the Rishus HaRabim within 4 Amis, he's going to collect the whole scroll and take it from the Rishus HaRabim into the Rishus HaYochid. And that would be seriously Osa. So we should say that even now that only part of the scroll fell, it should be Osa. V'chitema, are you going to suggest that given the mafsekes karmelis leslon bo, since there's something which is in between the Rishus HaRabim and the Rishus HaYochid, there's a karmelis in between, so he would never be taking it directly from the Rishus HaRabim into the Rishus HaYochid, it would be from the Rishus HaRabim first into the karmelis, which is only also the Rabbonon. V'ho'omarov, we can't say that. Did Rava not say hamaver chayfetz mitchilas arba l'soif arba? If somebody takes an object, an item, from one point in the Rishus HaRabim, and he takes it to another point 4 amos away in the Rishus HaRabim, v'heviro derech olov, and while he was in transit, he lifted it above 10 tvachim off the ground, above his head, and then that's not considered the Rishus HaRabim, and then he puts it back down in the Rishus HaRabim, nonetheless, chayev yochayev. So you see that carrying something from one point to another point, even though in between it's gone through a place which is not chayev, nonetheless, you're chayev. So here too, you're going to take the scroll from the Rishus HaRabim over the Karmelis into the Rishus HaYochid. It's considered, according to Rava, as if you took it from the Rishus HaRabim into the Rishus HaYochid, and you'll be chayev. So if so, in this case also, when the scroll rolled into the Rishus HaRabim, even if it's less than 4 amis away from the askupa, it should be also. Answers the Gemara. The Gemara is going to give two answers. Hocha b'mayoskinon ba'askupa aruka. We're talking about that this askupa is very, very long. And it fell beyond this Askupa into the Roshos HaRabim. But to get the scroll from the Roshos HaRabim all the way back to the Roshos HaYochid, you have to travel along the whole long Askupa. Adohachi v'ochi midkar. By the time he gets to, even before he reaches the house, he's going to remember, just a minute, this scroll was in the Roshos HaRabim. And if I'm going to just take it straight into the Roshos HaYochid, that's bad, seriously awesome. I better stop where I am, and then it will be considered as if I took it from the Roshos HaRabim into the Carmelis, which is only Asa Derabonon, and from the Carmelis into Roshos HaYochid, which again is only Asa Derabonon, and to protect the Kisvei Kodesh, that would be Mutter. Iboy Seima, another suggestion. La'oilom ba'askupa she'enu aruka. It could be that we're talking about an askupa which is not so long. Ustam Kisvei Kodesh yunim ayin buhu. And this is amazing. We should all be understanding this, that whenever you come to a sefer, Kisvei Kodesh, you don't just take it from place to place. The first thing you do is you open it and you show an interest and a curiosity. What does it say in the sefer? So this person, as soon as he brings it from the Roshos HaRabim into the Askupa, even before he takes it to the Bayis, he's going to stop and open up the sefer and read from it. And since that's what people all do, and he's umanachluhu, that means he's going to stop, where he rests in his place and open the sefer, therefore there's never a risk of him taking it from the Roshos HaRabim straight into the Roshos HaYochid. Asks the Gemara, V'leichosh, why are we not concerned? Dilma ma'ayin bu b'Roshos HaRabim. Maybe as soon as he picks up the sefer, he's going to open it up and see what's in it. He's going to learn from it. And then, whilst he's still in the Roshos HaRabim, when he's finished learning from it, he's then going to close the scroll and then continue taking it from where he is in the Roshos HaRabim straight to the Roshos HaYochid, via the Carmelis, but straight to the Roshos HaYochid. So what have we gained by saying that he's going to stop and study from the scroll? Well, he might do that before he reaches the Carmelis, and then we haven't gained anything. Because as soon as he finishes with that, he's going to go from the Roshos HaRabim to the Roshos HaYochid. And when he's finished, he's going to take it directly from the Roshos HaRabim over the airspace of the Askupa into the Roshos HaYochid. Answers the Gemara, Ho mani ben Azai, this is going according to Ben Azai, do Omar mahalich koimed domi. Ben Azai says that even if you don't stop, you're just walking, but every time you put your foot down, it's as if you've stopped. So even if you take it from the Roshos HaRabim, the very fact that you're going over the Askupa, you're stepping into the Askupa before stepping into the Roshos HaYochid, it's as if you did a Hanocha, it's as if you rested in the Carmelis, and therefore you will never transgress an Issa Deraisa of going from the Roshos HaRabim into the Roshos HaYochid. Asks the Gemara, V'dilma zorik lu mizrak, why are we not concerned? He's going to throw the scroll from the Roshos HaRabim over the Askupa into the Roshos HaYochid. Da'amar Rabbi Yechanon moida ben Azai bezorik. Rabbi Yechanon said that Ben Azai, who says that stepping over a Carmelis is as if you're resting in the Carmelis, that's only if you're walking and stepping there, but if you throw it, then even Ben Azai agrees that it's not considered as if you stopped there. And again, we have a risk of something going from the Roshos HaRabim straight to the Roshos HaYochid. Answers the Gemara, Omer of Achabar Avo, Zoy Seimeres Ein Mizrokin Kisvei HaKodesh. It's clear, and everybody knows, and this may be the source, one is not allowed to throw holy Sforim. You're not allowed to throw Kisvei HaKodesh. There's no risk of anybody taking a Kisvei HaKodesh and throwing it. Continues the Gemara. Hoyo koire b'roish hagag v'chulu. We saw the second case in the Mishnah. Somebody was reading from a scroll on the top of the roof, which is clearly Roshos HaYochid, and then v'nizgalgal ha-sefer, the sefer, or half of the sefer, the part of the sefer, rolled down towards the Roshos HaRabim. So we saw in the Mishnah that the Tanakhama say that as long as it hasn't reached the airspace of Roshos HaRabim, you can bring it back, which is till 10 tfachim. Rabbi Yehuda says as long as it's still suspended and it's not reached the ground, and Rabbi Shimon says that even when it reaches the ground, it's mutar. But when in the Chachomim, they said that if it reaches within 10 tefachim, then you're not allowed to bring it back. Hoif choy al aksav, you just turn it over onto its face, the letters facing down, and somewhat less exposed and a little bit more honorable for this ksav. Asks the Gemara Mishori, are you allowed to turn a sefer onto its face and put that sefer face down? V'atanya koisvei tsofrim tsvarim tfilin u'mezuzos. We learned in a brisa, the scribes, the sofrim who are writing the chofdalet tsvarim, they're writing tfilin, they're writing mezuzos. Lo hitiru len lafeich yiri al panah. If you want to protect the ksav, the text from getting dusty, we're not allowed to turn the whole scroll, the parchment, upside down. Most you can do is you can spread a garment on top of it to protect it, but you're not allowed to turn it upside down. How can the Rabbanon here say that you can turn it upside down? Answers the Gemara, Hosam Efshar. In the case of the Kosvei Sforim, there you've got that option. They have such a type of material, a garment, that they can put on top of the Sforim Tefillin Mezuzahs to protect it. Hochaloi Efshar, the Mishnah here is talking about where you do not have an available piece of material to protect the scroll, and therefore you have no choice. V'iloi opich, if you don't turn it over, ikka bizoyin, it's going to be a disgrace to kisvei kodesh, ikka bizoyin kisvei kodesh. Tvei, there's going to be more disgrace to the kisvei kodesh, and therefore you're allowed to turn it over. Continues the Gemara. Hoivchoi alaksav v'holoi noch. Why are you saying that if it's just reached the 10 amis, within 10 tefachim, sorry, from the ground, from the Rosh Hashanah, then you're not allowed to draw it back, you have to turn it on its face? It hasn't rested in the Rosh Hashanah. And if something hasn't rested in the Rosh Hashanah, then even if the whole scroll was there in a place where it's not rested, you're never going to be over from on carrying on Shabbos, on taking something from one Rosh Hashanah to another on Shabbos. It hasn't rested. So why can you not draw it back to you? Omar Rava answers Rava, Bekoisel Meshupa. We're talking about it has rested. We're talking that the wall is somewhat sloping, it's slanting, and when it reaches within 10 tefachim from the Rosh Hashanah Rabim, and it's resting on the slope, which means that it's not called dangling, it's not entirely suspended, it is resting on that sloped surface, and therefore it's called Hanocha. And since it's within 10 tefachim, according to the Chachomim, it's called Hanocha in the Rosh Hashanah Rabim, and you're not allowed to draw the scroll back to you. Omale Abaya. So Abaya is now commenting. But Mayu Kimtu L'masnisin. So how have you just explained our Mishnah? And you did that in order to explain the Chachomim. Is Bekoisul Meshupa. We're talking about a slanting wall where it was Munach. Eima Seifa. Let's move on to the next opinion in the Mishnah. Reb Yehuda. Reb Yehuda Oimer. Afilu Eine Mesulak Mina Oretz. Elo Maloyachut. Goylu Loyetzloi. Rabbi Yehuda says, as long as it hasn't landed in the Rosh Hashanah Rabim, you're allowed to bring the scroll back to you. Even if it's just a thread away from the Rosh Hashanah Rabim, it's not called landed. V'honochle, we're talking about a case where it is munach. It has rested. It's on a sloping wall. So how can Rabbi Yehuda say, as long as it hasn't reached the Rosh Hashanah Rabim, it's not called resting? Answers the Gemara, you have to read into the Mishnah as follows. Chisuri mechser v'hochi k'toni. Read it as follows. When do the Chachomim say that if it reaches within 10 tefachim, you're no longer allowed to draw it back? Bekoisel Meshupa, when it's a slanty wall and it's considered as its munach. Aval Bekoisel She'enei Meshupa, in the event that it's a wall that's totally vertical and it's not sloping at all, in that case, even if it goes below the point of 10 tefachim off the ground, you can still draw the sefer back to you. L'maylo mishloisha goyle le'etzloi. As long as it hasn't reached within 3 tefachim of the ground, you can still draw the scroll back to you. L'mato mishloisha, when it's within 3 tefachim off the ground, then you're not allowed to, because it's considered as if the earth, the floor, is a thickened earth, an aros smichta. And we've seen this before in Maseches Shabbos, that the 3 tefachim within Rosh Hashanah Rabim is almost as if it's Rosh Hashanah Rabim proper. It's called munach, and therefore you've got no choice. You cannot bring it back to you, even though it's only Asa Midrabbanon, because let's remember, half the scroll is on the roof still. But since if the whole scroll was in that place, it would be called munach. We're not allowing you to take the scroll back, and hoifchei alaksav, all you can do is turn the scroll over to protect it somewhat. Rabbi Yehuda Oimer, afilu einu mesulak min haaretz v'chulu. Rabbi Yehuda says that it's not good enough that it's within 3 tefachim off the ground. Even if it's within 3 tefachim off the ground, it's not called munach. And don't forget, we're talking here about a totally vertical wall. It's not sloping. Dabeinon anocha al gabe mashu. It has to be resting on something tangible, not on a lovud type of aros smichta, thickened earth. Ask the Gemara, so if so, we have a machlokes Tanakam and Rabbi Yehuda, whether something which is resting in the 3 tefachim off the ground, whether it's called munach or not called munach. Ve'elo hodo omarova. We had in a machlekes in Maseches Shabbos a discussion where the kluto kmisha huncha, which means when something goes over the airspace of a rishus, is it as if it's landed in the rishus? According to Rabbi Akiva, if something goes over rishus harabim and within 10 tefachim, it's as if it's landed in the rishus harabim. The chachamim say no. The chachamim say we don't say that the airspace is as if it's landed, and it has to land proper in order for it to be called munach. And Da'omar Rava, and Rava said that Toich Shloisha L'Rabbanon Tzorich Hanocha, even in the airspace within 3 Tvachim off the ground, it's not yet considered Munach. It's only Munach when it's actually on the ground. Leimu Ketanoi Omro L'Shmaite, then this that Rava says, that even within 3 Tvachim is not considered Munach, are you suggesting it's dependent on our Machlokes here? That according to the Tanakhama, within 3 Tvachim is considered Munach, and only according to Rabbi Yehuda, it's not called Munach? Elo kulo Rabbi Yehuda. No, the Gemara says you have to read the Mishnah. Let's read into the Mishnah yet something else. Uchesuri mechzer of a hochiktoni. This is how you have to read the Mishnah. But me devarim amurim. When is the halacha that if it falls within 10 tvachim, then you're not allowed to bring it back to the roof? Bekoisel meshupa. If it's the wall is sloping and then it's as if it's resting in the rishus harabim. Aval bekoisel she'ene meshupa. However, a wall which is not slanting, it's completely vertical, afilu pochis mishloisha tvachim, even if it reaches so close to the ground that it's less than 3 tvachim, goylu le'etzloi, he can still draw it back to him, because even within 3 tvachim is not called munach. And the reason is, share Rabbi Yehuda Omer, it's all Rabbi Yehuda, because Rabbi Yehuda says that afilu einu mesuluk min ha'oret, elo meloy achut, even if it's reached right to the ground, and it's just a fraction, the thickness of a thread off the ground, goylu le'etzlo, it's not yet called munach. If it's not called munach, then you can pull it back to you. My tama, deboin on anochal gabi mashu. Like we already saw before, that it's only called munach when it's actually resting on the ground and it's on a tangible surface. Continues the next Mishnah. Ziz shelifnei hachaloin. Somebody's got a home, Roshus Hayochid, with a window. That's all Roshus Hayochid, no issues. He's got a ledge beyond the window, outside the window. There's a ledge protruding from his wall. Noisnin olov, you're allowed to put things, any items, we'll soon see which items, but for now, any items you can take from the home and put it onto this windowsill. And not only onto the windowsill, you can put it onto the ledge beyond the window. V'noitlim menu b'Shabbos, not only you can put things onto this ledge, you can take things off the ledge on Shabbos. Says the Gemara, Haiziz, this ledge, demapik lehecha. It's over what type of domain is it extending? What's underneath it? Is the area beyond this ledge Rishus Harabim? Leichus Dilma Nofil. Why are we not afraid that he's going to put something on this ledge? It's going to fall into the Rishus Harabim. And he's going to go to Rishus Harabim and bring it back into his home. And that's going to be seriously awesome. Elo, it must be the mapik l'rishus hayochid. It must be that what's beyond this window, what's beyond this ledge, is his courtyard, is the chotzer, which is a rishus hayochid. If so, says the Gemara Pshita. So what's the Mishnah coming to tell us? If I've got my own home with the ledge sticking out of it, overseeing or over the chotzer, then of course I can put something from through my window onto the ledge. Omar Abaya says, le'olam demapik l'rishus harabim. No. You have to understand the Mishnah that there's a rishus harabim beyond this ledge. Umay noisnin olav diktoni. You're going to say, how can you put things on this ledge? They may fall down. You're going to take them from the rishus harabim. And you're going to carry from rishus harabim into the rishus hayachid. No. Kelim anishborim. We're talking about fragile, breakable kelim. And those utensils that are so breakable, in the event that they fall down, they're going to smash and nobody's going to go and bring the pieces back into the home. Continues the Gemara, Tanya Namihochi, we saw a brisa to this effect. Ziz shelifnei chaloin, if you have a ledge beyond a window, Hayoitzel Roshus Harabim, which is looking over Roshus Harabim, Noisnin olov, you're allowed to put on it, what? Ka'orois, plates, koises, cups, kitoinios, pitchers, tzloichios, flasks, umishtamish, bekola koisel. Even if the ledge is not just the width of the window, it's extending to the right and the left, the whole wall, then as any part that you can reach and you can get to, you can use the entire ledge. Providing, ad asora tachtoinim, providing that this ledge is not within 10 tfachim off the ground, in the airspace of the Rosh HaRabim. Ve'im yesh ziz echod lemato mimenu. If you have a ledge just flashed or just beyond the window, and you have another ledge underneath it, which is under the top ledge but still above 10 tvachim off the ground, then mishtamish boy, you're allowed to use the entire lower ledge, ube'elyoin, but in the upper ledge, in mishtamish boy elo keneged chaloinoi, and you're only allowed to use the part of the ledge which is opposite the window, not to the right or to the left. So now the first part of this braisa we understood very well, that you can use it, providing that you're only using it for breakables. This end, the last piece of the braisa, that if you've got two ledges, you can only use the lower ledge, not the upper ledge, only flash with the window. How do we read this? What does it mean? Says the Gemara, Hai ziz, hei chadomi. What's the status of this upper ledge that we have a problem using it and you're only allowed to use it flash with the window? Ida les be'arbo, if this whole ledge is less than four tvachim wide, mokim pturhu, then it's a mokim ptur. Since it's such a narrow place, then even though it's a mokim ptur and there's no issue with carrying from a Roshus Hayochid onto a mokim ptur, as we've seen with this amud bein Roshus Hayochid Roshus Harabim, but over here you're going to put something on this mokim ptur and you're not just adjusting some of your loads on here, you're permanently using this very narrow ledge, and it's things are constantly going to be falling off. So even if you're talking about breakables, but since most things you put on this very narrow ledge are going to fall into the Rosh HaRabim, it looks almost as if you're taking something from the Rosh HaYochid and throwing it into the Rosh HaRabim, because the whole time things are falling from this ledge into the Rosh HaRabim. It doesn't look right. So then if so, then even parallel to the window, you shouldn't be able to use this shelf. V'ispe'arbo, and in the event that this shelf is four tvachim wide, and that means it's a usable, it's something, a usable area, and things will not consistently fall off it. And as we said before, why should you not be able to use the whole upper ledge? Bekule koisul ishtamish, then use the whole upper ledge. Omar Abaya answers Abaya, tachtoin du'ispe'arbo, the lower ledge that you're allowed to use the whole ledge is indeed talking about that it's a wide ledge of four tvachim, and therefore there's no issue, things won't fall off it the whole time, and therefore you can use it. Ve'elyoin, the upper ledge, less be'arbo, it's less than four tvachim, and therefore to use the ledge where things are constantly going to be falling off is a problem. However, v'chaloinoi mashlimosoi ledalet, when if you take into consideration the width of the windowsill itself, then the windowsill together with the ledge is four tvachim. And therefore, keneged chaloin, flash with the window, where the area of this ledge with the windowsill is four tvachim, things won't fall off it. Mishtamish, he can use it. Dechoyrei chaloinu, it's just an extension, the ledge is just an extension of the window. Dehai gisa, or dehai gisa, however, the shelf, this ledge, on the right of the window and the left of the window, also, since over there you don't have the windowsill with it, it's less than four tvachim, things will constantly be falling off it, and therefore you're not allowed to use that part of the ledge. In Mirtz Hashem, in the next shir, we're going to continue the next Mishnah.